shortened this a little bit for you guys. I now know why I hate it. All my construction projects are late. I told people in the back, that's why I always put a little contingent in mind that if you're on time, you actually get your full amount of feet. It's nice to be with you today. I'll try to get you. The reason is I'm a golfer. I'm not playing today, but I understand tee time, so we'll have you out, I promise. We're going to talk about the economy. How many were at the Greenbrier when I spoke there? Not half of you. Okay, so I love you guys. Y'all go to really rough places to have your meetings. It's kind of nice. We're going to talk a little bit about North Carolina today and sort of what's been going on and what the trends are. I'll leave time for questions. You can ask me all the hard ones you want. There's lots of fun ones these days. I did the North Carolina Chambers meeting the other day, their televised thing. I think I got all the hardest questions that there were. So you guys probably don't have to do it today for us. How's the economy? I asked you this question 3 years ago. I remember the answers. I went back and looked at the presentation back then and what I told you was true. And got some of it right. So I want you to grade the U.S. economy for me. A, B, C, D, F. So how many A's? B's? C's, D's, F's, good crowd, y'all understand it a little bit better. North Carolina economy, A's, B's, C's, D's, where are you from?
Greensboro.
F's, your local community's economy. And I looked, about half of you are from either Raleigh, Greensboro, or Charlotte, so your local community, A's. Where from?
D.U.K.
Okay. and he's right about the economy. Where are you from?
Chapel
Hill. B's? C's? Where are you from?
Greensboro.
You?
I'm from Graham.
Graham? Okay. Like a theater. You guys?
Winston.
So Triad. D's? Where are you from?
Triad.
Okay. And F's?
Yes.
Okay. So here's the question for you, though. What were you thinking about when you graded? And the question of what the economy is like is really a product of what factors you put into it. So what were you thinking? What factors in your head were there? How much money you were making? Okay. So you know you're sitting here in Disneyland Resort. You look like you're doing okay. I saw your family, I mean, things look like they're pretty good. that's a D, okay.
White-collar job.
White-collar jobs, and what'd you give it?
I gave it a C. In Greensboro, I gave it a C minus.
Okay.
Maybe a D plus.
All right, what were you measure?
I would rest on the unemployment.
Unemployment, right. What'd you give it?
A.
Okay, good. Smart. Anybody else? What were y'all thinking? I mean, you're measuring the economy. What were you measuring?
New
construction. That's a good answer for this group. What else? Job growth. I mean, think about it. I mean, some people measure the stock market. Some measure GDP, which is probably the most logical answer.
Population.
If I'm in a different room, everybody's talking about wage growth. I mean, different rooms think about different things for the economy. So when you say, how's the economy? Stupid question. I know I asked it, but it's still a stupid question because I don't know what you're measuring. For my company, if somebody says, how are things, profit usually is them, you know, how's payroll going? You know, how are we having a profit? Are we having, how's the pipeline? I mean, we think about lots of those kind of things. But how my business is doing has absolutely, you know, it's no reflection on the general economy. We actually made more money in the recession. Because everybody was, you know, running around trying to figure out, well, what are we doing, what are we doing? So they hired us to tell them, you can't do anything. Hunker down and wait. Here's our invoice, it's great. It's lovely. It's a wonderful, great line. Okay, y'all know that the stock market and the unemployment rate are inversely related too, right? You do 50 years of, you know, as the stock market goes up, I mean, so you can't have everything in an economy work. So in a room where the stock market should be, it can be going great and get all A's and unemployment goes, I mean, think about it. You know, you buy stock when people lay off people, because that's when it's good. So how you think about the economy is really important. So we're going to spend a few minutes looking at data. We're going to spend the first half of this talking about data. We're going to spend the second half talking about policy and what what that's been doing. So, now we're going to give you a bunch of data. I work for D's and R's, so you're not getting any data from me that is politically opinionated. You will get stuff that's opinionated because all data is subjective, but it's not going to be politically, I promise you that. Because I can't vote people mad, and I do regularly. I go to the General Assembly, we speak, I present three times a year to their Economic Development and Global Engagement Committee. Don't know why, it's an EDGE, makes a nice acronym, so that's why they call it that. And I usually have the Republicans and Democrats on the committee equally mad at me. That's good. So we'll start globally, because we always do, because half the world lives in that circle. And the other half lives everywhere else. And if you don't believe the global economy is the most important thing for the U.S. economy, we can certainly prove that to you. So we start looking at unemployment rates. And so this is what happened in 2000, from the last 5 years, should say 5 years. From 2011 to 2016, and I'll show you some stuff on how unemployment is measured in just a second for all skeptics. This is U.S. unemployment drop from 9% to 5%. This is European unemployment. It's actually gone up. They're roughly the same size economy. If you look at Canada, still exactly the same at 7%. Look at Brazil. These are the people we were afraid of in 2011. In Russia, globally, unemployment probably has somewhere around 500 million people who want a job that there's not enough jobs for. Anybody believe we're in a global economy? So what happens in a global economy when the supply of labor is higher than the demand of labor? What happens to wages? Right? They drop, right? So we read every day in the paper, what would it mean we don't know why wages are stagnant? That's because we have 500 million more people looking for work than we have jobs. Real simple answer, we don't like the answer. This is a really simple answer. GDP, over the last 4 years, everybody's been trying to figure out what do you do to jumpstart GDP. And this is what the US GDP looks like for 4 years. And this year doesn't look much different. Japan's back. If you go before 2013, you get lots of recessions for a decade and a half. They almost made it back to 2% 1 year, and then they're down. China has been coming down pretty dramatically after averaging over 10% for 30 years, continues to drop. Canada's in the same boat we are. Europe's barely out of recession. India, Mr. Modi and his changes in India have them as the only sort of bright light in all of this. And here are half the brick companies that we were completely afraid of in full recessions. So what's happening with global growth? Slow, real slow. So what happens if you have real slow global growth and you're an integrated economy like the US is for growth? Slow, right? Yeah, I'll do it. The problem is that you press the wrong button here, and so I'm not used to holding this side of the thing, so it's gonna be tough today. Now, growth forecast for the last, back in, after 2011, everybody thought growth could come about here by now. And then a year later they revised it, and a year later they revised it, and a year later they revised it, and now we're down here. The best estimates now is that we're going to have 2.5% growth for the foreseeable future, 3, 4, 5 years. No better. And I understand we have some people running for office, some that used to be running for office, who says, you can make this 5% easy. You can't. Possible. I'll show you why in a few minutes. So we have recession, right? Longest, deepest recession in history. We're now all the way over here. We're 14 million jobs net out of the bottom. We're 5 million jobs above where the recession is, and we're almost back. After 8 years, we're almost back to the level that would put us even with the employment growth from the beginning. No real growth, but almost even. Forever. Really tough 8 million job loss, and now we're back up on the other end. Oops, you don't deal with it. So this is job growth in America over the last 15 years. The last 2 years, the best two job growth years since the 1990s. So if you're measuring jobs in general, The last 2 years have been A's, given our current curve, if you will. This year, first 3 months were pretty good. April came out yesterday. This brand new number was 160,000 yesterday. And honestly, the first quarter for the last 3 years have been ridiculously bad. And then the second quarters have been much better than people expected. So nobody knows if April means anything. 160 is still not bad, by the way. But the estimate was 200,000 net new jobs, and it's lower than that. So who knows? Right now, the projections that we have for 2016 are that we'll be closer to the 2 million range than the 3 million range. So a little bit slower growth than we've had in the past. The main reasons for that is really tough sectors in energy, in commodities, in manufacturing. This is what it looks like on a chart for the last bunch of years. I mean, for anybody who gets excited on a month-to-month basis, you can see what month-to-month looks like, so just don't pay much attention. Rolling averages, month-to-month look. You know, 6 month averages is really the closest thing you should look at. But here's that one that makes people crazy right now, which is the employment population ratio. And this is the Bureau of Economic Analysis. I'm not a big fan of starting at 54 on a chart, but you can see that we're back to the levels of the 1980s of the population that's actually working. So the utilization curves for us on people working is pretty low. And this is that crazy set of numbers that nobody used to think anything about, but has become political. So this is our unemployment rate, always has been our unemployment rate. So we'll be talking about forever. That's the U3 rate. This is the U6 rate, which counts all people who quit looking for work because they were discouraged, and all the people who are working part-time but say they're doing it for economic reasons. And that number, if you're ever faced with trying to understand that number, the easiest thing in the world is to take the current unemployment rate and just double it. And that's about how many people are either discouraged or out of the market or whatever. So it's always been like that, and it's gotten better in recent years, but because of this number, we're having a real tough time among the economic world trying to figure out, why aren't people working? Why aren't they staying home? There's a bunch of answers to that. Yeah.
Is that total population or population of employment age?
It's employment age population.
Employment age ratio.
This ratio is actually total, but all of this is employment age. Yeah.
So under total.
It doesn't count children under 18. It does, because so many now.
Yeah, we have so many.
70, it does.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's got to come down.
This is North Carolina's, by the way. We do worse than the national average. Now, part of this is because North Carolina's women in the workforce numbers are lower. Bible Belt community, less women work here. Sorry, women in the room. Some of you have met my wife, you know that she's worked, you know. I'm not one of those people, but in North Carolina, not so much, although getting better last year. Don't know why, before it went back, but when this is traditional for us to be a little bit lower, that goes all the way back to right before the recession. This is North Carolina's income numbers compared to the national ones. Less during the recession, slightly more during good times, because we're one of the highest stakes for manufacturing jobs. Manufacturing jobs are more dependent on recession. Good times, lots of manufacturing jobs, lots of overtime. Bad times, no manufacturing jobs, no overtime. And so states that are big into food production don't have those kind of swings during recession. You eat just as much. But if you're the type of state that makes things, then you all know that during recession, you don't buy durable goods very much. And so that's why we look a little less. The biggest issue that we're facing from a wage standpoint and a growth standpoint is productivity. It is the lowest now that it has been since the 70s. We're actually averaging just over 1% productivity gains. And this is what we got used to. We got used to this sort of really fast productivity growth during the IT revolution of the 90s, and then it's been flattening out. And frankly, most people, we don't know why for sure. Most people believe that productivity today is about effort. I'm not saying people are lazy, but I'm saying that we've created a system now where the harder you work for a lot of our population, that there's really not a heavy reward for that. Now, the highest productivity growth we've had in recent years was 2009. Remember, when you were laying off half your workers and the other half were scared to death and worked really hard. In recent years, not so much. I'll show you another chart later on this. So in the South, we do a lot of work with the Southern governors, and these just, you never know who to compare to. These are all the Southern states. This is what's happened in the last 12 months. And here's North Carolina, not the highest state. Highest state's over here in Tennessee. So there's Tennessee. There's Georgia. Florida's ahead of us. Virginia ahead of us. But we're right up there in the top group. So pretty good for North Carolina. If you happen to be in oil, gas, or coal, not very good right now, right? So, by the way, all three of these states were the first out of the recession in 2010, and were flying high, and everybody was trying to figure out what are they doing that's got them out of the recession. And the answer was oil and gas and coal. And if you're into that, you know that energy stakes can really fluctuate pretty heavily. This is what North Carolina, this is where our growth comes from. So this is us compared over the last 12 months with what's happening nationally. So overall, we're growing faster than the national average. Growing faster in construction, that's both residential and commercial. Doing okay, better than the nation in manufacturing. There's a myth going around that there's been this huge resurgence in manufacturing jobs. There's a resurgence in manufacturing output because of robotics and automation. There is not a resurgence. We lost 7 million or so manufacturing jobs during the run-up in the recession, and we've gained back 700,000. Gaining back some is good, but it's not a resurgence in manufacturing. But we've been better than overall, and that's one of the reasons is we've lost most of our low-wage manufacturing jobs, and we tend to be higher-wage girls and boys, and that's done a little better. Trade doing better, financial doing better, professional business services much better. That's those white-collar jobs you were talking about. Health and education less. Some of this is policy, and some of it's other things. Leisure and hospitality a little better, and we're actually growing government at a lower rate than the rest of the country. So I threw South Carolina up here just because everybody likes to play about South Carolina these days. I grew up in Gaston County, about 6 miles from the border, and so we like to talk bad about South Carolina. So I wanted to point out that one of the things that South Carolina's job growth, I'm just going to point out one thing on the chart. South Carolina, both the Hilton Head Metro, the Charleston Metro and the Myrtle Beach Metro are three of the fastest growing residential construction markets in America. I think they're three of the top 10. So people are moving in droves to the South Carolina coast, and you're getting a South Carolina bump in employment driven a lot by this construction number. So when we start looking at things, here's financial services, and I'm saying there are things that are good and bad between North Carolina and South Carolina. South Carolina's overall growth rate is 2.7, ours is 2.5. We have discussions on South Carolina cleaning North Carolina's block here or there, but not really true. Just this growth along the coast is the biggest thing. By the way, this one gets me in more trouble than any other chart. If you think that local governments at the state level make much difference in how your economy grows, this is the North Carolina job growth percentage back to 1990 compared with the national job growth percentage. What does the chart tell you? How goes the national economy is how goes our economy. Little lower here, little higher there. Why is that? I told you that. Manufacturing, though. So we'll go down a little more and up a little more based on manufacturing. And by the way, if you're a commodity state, if you're a food state, or if you're an energy state, you might change a little bit. This is North Carolina. That puts South Carolina on top of it for you. And then I just put some of the most conservative, most liberal states in the country on top of that. So everybody running for office, or every governorship in North America who claims they can change the economy, there's your charts. Now, they tend to, that doesn't mean they can't change sectors. So you favor one sector over another sector, but that tends to be a little bit like that, you know, whack-a-mole. You push this down, this goes up. Again, we don't not favor either party, just pointing out that this is sort of the way life works. This is our metros in North Carolina. Last 12 months, Jacksonville actually losing jobs, Rocky Mount still losing jobs, Raleigh gained the highest percentage jobs, here's Asheville, a little bit different. So certainly, when you start looking at the growth in the state, then this is metro only, we'll show you the rural sector. Raleigh metro area, Raleigh, you know, more you can say right now than Durham, although Durham's doing well. And the reason for Durham's a little bit downfall is the biotech industry is having a lot of issues these days. So Raleigh and Durham pretty well, Charlotte doing pretty well, Asheville doing pretty well. Everybody else doing okay. Remember the states, you know, this is 2.6 of metro growth. So some metros, not so much. This is where the labor force, where people are moving and growing. So this is the last, this is Charlotte. When you add Raleigh and Durham together, you get to 40. And that's what's happening where people are locating in the state. So are they locating predominantly in those two core metros? Yes, they are. And this is the growth in there. If you look at, so the triad for those of you, Burlington is three metros. So you got Burlington at about 2,000, Greensboro, so that's 12, and Winston-Salem about 20. So growing about half the rate of the Charlotte and Raleigh metros.
Where's High Point?
High Point is Winston-Salem, High Point's in the Greensboro metro. So it'd be great. And by the way, metros have nice long names, and you can't really make them work on charts. So, you know, for instance, this is the Raleigh-Cary Metro. This is the Durham-Chapel Hill. They're all, they all have long names. So sorry for not putting all the names up there, but just that way. So we do have that kind of thing in the state. And when you look at it for the, every county in the state, so the darker greens are the counties that are growing at or above the state average. So here's the triangle group. Guilford County is growing above the state average. Here's the Charlotte region. Here's all this stuff around Asheville and people growing up in the mountains. Brunswick County down here. The yellows are growing, but they're growing below the state average, so 0 to 3.2. And the reds are still losing jobs all these years after the recession. This is employment. So that means people who live in those counties. It's not the jobs in the counties, it's people in the counties. So this is our, we get this question probably more than any other question. How competitive is North Carolina? So A, B, C, D, F, how competitive is North Carolina? A, B, you're right by the way. C, D, F. Why are we uncompetitive? Okay. So when people start looking at competitiveness, this is what corporate CEOs say they look at. Availability of skilled labor, number one, high wage accessibility, quality of life, and structure cost. Not timing, but a little cost, I would say. Buildings, labor. So this is what they look at. So y'all know that we are ranked sort of the best this, that, and whatever by almost everybody who ranks, right? I'll show you why this is actually true in a minute. What we can do, one of the things our company does for companies is look at hundreds of factors. And so this is tax climate. This is all the southern states. And if you're green up here, you're one of the 15 best states. If you're red, you're one of the 15 worst states. If you're tan, you're in the 20 middle. So everybody thinks Texas, by the way, is a great tax state, right? Low taxes in Texas? Right. All right. So Texas is a low individual income tax state. It is actually a high business corporate tax state. It is a high sales tax state, and it's one off from having on the red here as a high property tax state. Texas, when measured in tax revenues collected, is actually one of the higher states. But they do it through local property and sales tax rather than corporate income tax. You can decide, you know, for those of you who have a corporation, yay, but for those of you who are sole proprietorship, this is not going so good in fact. So when we look at this, North Carolina, 15th best overall, 70 corporate, 14 individuals. So we're getting better and better and better at income. And these continue to rise. So the General Assembly's current philosophy, and the philosophy of most conservative General Assemblies, is less corporate, more individual. But that's a choice. For us, that's a public policy choice as to where you want to collect your money. This is regulatory and legal environment. North Carolina 14th best regulatory environment in America. Who are the lawyers in the room? 5th best legal environment in America. Now, just by the way, if you, anybody from Mississippi? If I asked you, how is it to do business in Mississippi, the answer would probably be, well, you can do anything in Mississippi, right? So here's Mississippi. When we come over here, one of the worst regulatory environments, one of the worst economic freedom, which is starting businesses, and the worst legal environment in America.
I believe that.
So is everybody who's ever been to Mississippi practicing law. They tell me this, oh yeah, absolutely true. Because I've asked, I said, what's the deal? Well, it's unpredictable, it's slow, it's, you know. So, I mean, what do companies want? They want speed, they want low risk, they have, so pretty good shape. We're in good shape there. When we look at taxes, a tax isn't a tax isn't a tax. Because in North Carolina, the most useless number for any state is what's the corporate income tax, because the exemption book is this tall. So when you start looking at different types of businesses, and you include the total cost of doing businesses, income, property, sales, unemployment insurance, health. So here's North Carolina's rankings. And oh, by the way, here are our friends in South Carolina's current rankings. And Texas, by the way, since we think they're so wonderful. North Carolina's a very competitive state. So we like to figure it out a little bit more than that. We said, all right, so all these are going to rank you. Let's look at all those rankings and give them an average. And then let's look at the economy and see how your wage growth, your job growth, and your GDP growth react. How are they correlated? So in fact, are the best ranked places the ones with the best results? And these are the states with the best. And we're actually ranked a little bit higher than our results. But we're down here in the top 20, as is Texas, Colorado and Utah and Nebraska and Florida. Then up here are the people who are ranked terribly and perform terribly. So that's New Mexico and Connecticut and Maryland. So people in the middle. And then you have a few outliers. So for instance, Virginia for this last year didn't do very well, but it's ranked pretty high. Anybody know the reason? I like that answer. No, sequestration killed Virginia. When we cut the federal government, we cut military, both Northern Virginia and Newport News area just got killed. So their fundamentals are still good, but the sugar daddy took a hit, right? Then we have these people down here who do better than we think. There's California. On all those other things I showed you, California scores near the bottom. Except that we're not measuring venture capital, university output, proximity to Asia. We don't measure that stuff. And so when you start looking at sort of the, if you will, the liberal places, New York, Massachusetts, California, they have a different model. Their business model is different, but their performance is in the top 20. And so this idea that, you know, and that's job, wage, GDP. So this idea that just because you don't have this, you can't be that, not true. So we're going to change gears for you. These are my grandparents. All four of them. I do not know why Roy hasn't gone. Somebody's going to ask me, and I do not know. Theoretically, according to my mother, this picture was taken the day I came home from the hospital in 1957, before. So my grandfather's farm, they brought me home, and you can tell how happy everybody was. First grandchild, both sides, first grandchild. And that's how happy they look. That's the world of 1957, right? So none of those people went past eighth grade. None of those people ever had a passport, never got on an airplane, never saw a computer. All four were farmers who ended up going to work second or third shift in textile mills. These two were J.P. Stevens and Stanley. These two were bonehead outside of Dallas. That was the world. And by the way, all four of them died when I was in college. So I got to go to my grandparents, and then sort of one generation back. Today, the world's a bit different. Although you probably can carry your gun now, as long as you can see it out of the belt, I guess. But one of those big trends, and y'all talked about some of them already this morning. The biggest one facing everybody is what's happening in the South with urbanization, which is a global phenomenon, right? So this was what happened to Shanghai in the last 10 years. 10. 10. That's Pudong. Pudong was a swamp, and that's what happened in the world. We've been changing in America. The dark areas are growing. The lightest areas are shrinking. And so we end up in America today with here's the triangle all the way over to Guilford. Here's Charlotte. Here's this. We're down here right now. You can see there are lots of areas that are growing big time, but a lot of America is shrinking. And what's happened with people moving, and we're just going back to 2000 here, is everybody's moving south or west. So southern part of the country, big growth, and this is pre and post recession of those two bars. And oh, by the way, college grads, more educated, are moving into poor cities. What's happening with people's movement is just different than it used to be. There's a Howard Cowan, an economist at George Mason, has actually done more work. It's not just cities even. So this is the US population growth. This is urban city population growth. And this is the top 50 ranked city growth. It's not just cities, it's specific cities. And so we end up, even though North Carolina has had really strong, one of the most highest population growth in the country, we end up, when we look at it, sort of, generically, almost everybody's growing. And again, this is the higher, over 6% growth, and a little bit lower. Yes, nobody here is based out here, right? We have a construction company, and they don't have people out here, right? A few places that are shrinking. But overall, population growth has been pretty good. But as we move forward, this is the state's official map, the hashed areas are actually expected to shrink between now and 2035. The dark areas are expected to grow very quickly, and everybody else just a little. We are, as a state, dividing out, and different parts of the state are growing pretty rapidly. From 2000 to 2014, jobs in our 20 urban counties, we added 250,000. In our 80 rural counties, we lost 100,000. In our urban counties, we added 500,000 more people to the labor force. In our rural counties, we didn't lose many. So what does that mean? It means that these guys are now still there, but they're having to commute to get to work. And more people living in the urban core. It wasn't a bunch of policy decisions. A lot of it was the fact that jobs changed. So both urban and rural areas lost manufacturing jobs, construction jobs. But the jobs that we were gaining, huge growth in financial services, none in rural areas. Business and professional services, overwhelming in urban areas. Education, the places we're growing jobs today are urban-type jobs. The places where the types of jobs we're losing are rural-based jobs. That makes it harder and harder. And so the question is, so what, right? So this is a trend, so what? So we just finished a major project for the North Carolina Chamber looking at how do you grow rural North Carolina. Any luck at all, on Tuesday, Senator Gunn will come out with a whole set of legislative agendas on what to do to help rural North Carolina. And some of those are help with construction projects, building sites, other things in rural North Carolina. The answer is you have to build their product better. They can't compete right now. So the stuff y'all talked about this morning, they also don't have the intellectual and sophistication to figure out what they ought to do. So all the help you can give them, great. I'll sort of write off the fact that we do that for a living, and you are giving it away, but okay. I love that guy. But we also think they've got to have better broadband, they've got to have better buildings and sites, they've got to have better training and employment. That you have to build a better product. And even then, there's still a throttle on it because most of the best educated people are migrating to urban areas and most of the best new jobs are migrating there. The demographics continue to shift on us too. If you want to read one book, I got a couple in here, but The Next America is a great simple read by Paul Taylor. It talks just about what the demographic shifts are doing. And in America, the number one demographic shift is that gray hair is becoming the thing, right? The problem with gray hair becoming the thing is when you start looking at retirement income and savings for most of America's gray people, they are not going to be able to maintain their lifestyle. But I predict to you right now that if you want to get into lower cost elderly housing, not covering subsidies, but lower cost, it's going to be a huge market. Because the average amount of savings won't last people 5 years. And, oh, by the way, they're going to live 25 years. If you look at home ownership rates right now, the most of the groups, home ownership's dropping. People want, they want to rent because it's temporary. They want to rent music, they want to rent clothes, they want to rent housing. Look at who's the renters, who's the biggest growth. Look at this. This is older renters. It's not young renters that are the biggest jump. It's older renters. They're arbitraging their savings, selling their house, reverse mortgaging, doing all of that kind of stuff because they need to. Big change in the marketplace. The biggest overall change, though, is technology. Technology is changing just about everything we do. And so the best book in the last couple of years was Rise of the Robots. Martin Sporer's book is a readable book. If you really want to get geeked out, you read The Second Machine Age, which is a little deeper. But this whole idea of what technology is going to do to our labor market is probably the hottest public policy issue that we face today. So back in 1953, we started getting all of this stuff written about how automation was going to change our jobs. I'm going to read you this because it's like, new skills, a shorter work week, and more leisure time will be yours by 1975. Thanks to machines with brains. Now, some of that 58, some of you are in that same sort of ballpark. You remember that science fiction's promise was not that technology would take away our jobs. It was that technology would give us leisure time. We'd be George Jetson. We'd have a two-day work week, 1 hour a day pressing a button. Digital index operator, I believe, correct term. That was what the promise was. That is not what happened. What happened is auto workers now look like that. And waitresses in Asia look like that. That's what a new cook looks like at a fast food restaurant. They tell me that Waffle House is not far from being able to do that. That thing will make you wrong. That's a heart surgeon. Those are nurses down there helping. And that's before Watson's virtual reality and thinking comes into play. This is what I'll be in 3 years when I'm back. Although, if you keep going my place, I might not. This is what technology looks like today. We already have clothes that you don't have to wash because nothing sits on them. We already have robots that have the manual dexterity to even tie shoes. We have, this is the Harry Potter model where everything is interactive based on your proximity to it. That's real today. That's a ticket taker at a Tokyo movie theater. She's synthetic. That's data for those next generation fans in the room. She interfaces now. So a lot of people have done all this work out of Oxford on the probability that your job will be taken away by a robot in the next few years. If you're an accountant, 94% odds. If you're an economist in the middle, about half. I'm old, that's a good one. So, the better news probably for those of you in the room is that the odds of your minister bidding, So you're probably not going to have to listen to a machine preach to you, but he'd probably be done on time, probably. That's good. A lot of work done at NC State on where the disruptions are going to have the highest impact. So here's the triangle, not very high impact. Look at our rural areas. Routinized jobs are going to disappear in bigger and bigger numbers. That's harder and harder to deal with in rural areas. And jobs themselves have changed pretty dramatically. When you look at North Carolina industry changes over that period of time, lots of losses. You know, this is 42% of our jobs since 2000. We lost a whole bunch of manufacturing jobs in the 90s. Most of the textile jobs are already gone by then. And then the places that are growing, health, professional, technical services. So when you look at jobs and unemployment rates by education level, if you're college educated, and this was updated yesterday, 2.4%. if you had a college degree, even in the depths of the recession, the odds of you being unemployed were about 4%, which is full employment. But if you were less educated, your odds go up pretty dramatically. More importantly, what we pay for skills has diverged. So the more education you have, not only are your wages higher, they're going up faster. And if you have less education or less skills, it's a proxy for skills, they've been flat or reduced. In fact, if you look back to the 1990s, people, men and women divided here, with less education or less skills, their actual real wages have been dropping, or people with the highest have been going up the most. So what's been happening is, if you buy some of the research, again, nobody being mean, but if Jim has skills that are high and highly in demand, and there is nobody else in the room that has Jim's skills, what do we pay Jim? Anything, right? You know, but if Tony has skills that lots of people have, and we need fewer of them because robotics and automation, what happens to Tony's skills and his wages? His skills don't rise, his wages drop. And that's what we've been seeing more and more. So when you look in there at the state, where the percent of people with a BA are higher than the state average, this is it. They've concentrated. So when you start trying to figure out what's happening to rural North Carolina, part of it is just the real shift in where jobs are. And when you look at poverty rates in North Carolina, which is something people deal with a lot, it's exactly what you expect it to be. Bad news for men is overall, median pay for inflation has been flat now for almost 40 years. Women have been rising. Part of that is because women have been getting much higher education levels over that period of time. And then this is the one that sort of makes some parts of the political system lose their minds, which is productivity gains, even though they've been relatively flat recently, since the 1970s have risen much faster than compensation. Now, who's quick? I mean, what's the reason for this? Why are we not distributing more money to our employees?
Manufacturing.
What was it?
Well, manufacturing. I mean, you know, that's where the
that's part of it.
Right.
What? Robotics is part of it. What else? So, how many of you have been in business for more than 20 years? Okay. 20 years ago, how much of your income that you paid for employees was salary, and how much was benefits? And what's changed? Right? Also, that robotics and automation, well, in between those two is your capital cost. And those machines you're buying now are a lot more expensive than those machines you used to buy. That thing that makes automobiles is expensive. Now, it's not expensive when you figure in it runs 24/7 and does whatever, but your costs have changed. Now, we can have a long discussion about the morality of all this, but that's the fact. When you look at household income in North Carolina, the state average household, median household income is $46,000. The green counties are the only ones at or above that amount. The red counties are below 80% of it. So when you look at where the wages and the disposable income and everything, you see where they are.
Yeah.
I have a question. Is that Dare County up there? What is driving Dare County?
Rich Washingtonians, they being there. They're retiring there. Dare County, by the way, anybody from Dare? Dare County is the Disneyland of North Carolina fiscal counties. They have almost no kids. The average house value is like $400,000. Their tax rate brings in ridiculous amounts of money. And they have very, very high unemployment in the winter. Yeah. And they don't know what to do. Because if they got jobs for all those people in the winter, they wouldn't have any jobs for people. They wouldn't have any people for the jobs in the summer. So you got this paradox. But this is what's happened all along our coast, is wealthy people are retiring there. Their household income is not usually wages, it's usually investment income. Now they bring that down with them from the Northeast. I'm a lifelong North Carolinian, but I don't have anything against the Northeast. It's just that's where most of the people are coming from. But that's what happens to that. So I wanted to ask y'all a question today, because we've been doing this around the country, and we'll finish up in just a few minutes. What does a good job pay? How much does a good job pay annually? Let's assume it's full-time, let's assume it has some benefits, but not Cadillac benefits, but benefits. How much annually or per hour is a good job hire?
$75,000.
What'd you say? But I go, this is wherever you live. What is it pay? All right, so how many people think, somebody give me a lower number than 75? 50. All right, how many people think a good job pays 50,000 or more? Raise your hand. All right, good job. All right. And how many do you think it pays less? What's a good job pay?
In North Carolina?
Yeah, wherever, yeah.
Well, if you go by what the state goes, it's going to be about $30,000, $32,000 a year.
$30,000 a year, okay. How much? So here's one of the other public policy makes your head, you know, you've seen those commercials now where your head goes purple. Right, this is the purple poof. So this is all the jobs in North Carolina. And there are 358,000 that pay $80,000 a year or more. And you add these two together, that pays $60,000 a year or more. When you add these three together, that pays $40,000 a year or more. And the other group of North Carolina full-time jobs pay that. So what y'all have just declared is that two-thirds of the jobs in North Carolina are bad jobs. So when you start looking, I mean, maybe it's just North Carolina, but it's not. Here's the U.S. and here's us. So half of the jobs in North Carolina pay $20,000 to $40,000. So what half the people make who work full-time. And so what makes people's head explode is trying to figure out, well, we want everybody in here, I bet, wants everybody who can to work. I know I'm in that mode too. I don't want to support anybody who can work. But it's hard because a lot of the jobs, and this is not, again, this is nobody's fault. This is nobody's political agenda. You look at nationally, you look at most of the states, they look like Connecticut's sort of the outlier because there are a lot of low-wage jobs there. But this is sort of the structure of our economy. And structurally, so some of you will tell me you have trouble finding employees, right? So what type of skills do you have trouble finding?
Skill labor.
So pick a skill for me. Carpenter. Good carpenter. How much does a good carpenter make? Right, so it makes 40 grand a year, right? So he's right there on that edge of this.
That's 50 with the overtime.
With the overtime, okay, but that's fine. I mean, because a lot of jobs don't have, in fact, some of these jobs, you get 31 hours and you know how we play those games, so. But yeah.
I'm gonna ask you to go back one slide.
Sure. Oops, sorry.
Skilled trades, I would submit, are in that middle band, the 859 band.
This one?
Because of overtime.
Yeah. I agree with that. Yes, sir.
Does any of this go back to that slide you showed early on about our about North Carolina being good for business, and that we've shifted a lot of our tax burden to individuals, so our state's good for having out-of-state companies put their lower-wage workers here, and their higher-wage folks don't want to live here because of our high taxes on individuals. It's going to push people away.
It's a legitimate marker, right? One of the things that we spend a lot of time trying to talk to legislators or town council is that economics, by and large, is a group of math problems that are defined by choices we make. Mm-hmm. That's what you elect public people to do, is make public policy choices. You don't elect them to change the math because they can't, even though they might tell you they care. The math is what it is, right? So if you have higher taxes on individuals, the odds are less individuals. You have lower taxes. You have exemptions for R&D. The reason we have exemptions for R&D is because that encourages R&D to be here. If we have exemptions for, you know, gross profits of large headquartered financial services companies, the reason we do that is because we want to keep Wells Fargo and Bank of America and others here. I mean, we do it, we use public policy, we move the math with our public policy. We tend to argue the math and we rarely get down to arguing public policy. And that's the issue. Yeah.
Well, if you could flip the switch today and change something public policy-wise, not math-wise, what would you do with that switch? What would you change?
What do you want the outcome to be?
Well, you would preferably go from 15
to maybe one or two of, you know, economically attractive states, and you would see that shift, hopefully. Push jobs to make more money, lower unemployment.
Okay, so who are you envious of? Which state?
Well, Florida.
Okay. I mean, okay, so Florida. So how many people here are envious of Florida?
I'm from Florida.
So yeah. I
set
you up. Because of personal income. So they're all choices. That's the point. Is they're all choices, and they're all whack-a-mole choices, or balloon choices, where you push and pull. That's part of the issue, right? And so for me, I mean, what are you doing? You're trying to balance. I mean, the problem we'll have now in North Carolina, and lots of states will have, is that when you start looking, and we maintain a database for companies and states of over 400 factors. So if you're spending less on taxes, what are you spending less on, traditionally? Now, we may give it back to you, and that's a philosophical thing. We already have more of his money because he's better able to decide what to do with his money than the state is. Strong argument. But we have less of Artie's money, so we're going to pay teachers less. And we're going to fill less potholes. And we're going to whatever. Whatever we spend money on. The concept that we're going to waste a whole lot less money is, whatever. I mean, I've worked for government. I've worked for big companies. I worked for the Clark Construction Group. Everybody wastes money on the things they want to waste money on, and they don't waste money on much else. Right? So what do? What do you push?
Yeah. A little bit different question, but is there any measure of the underground economy?
No, great question. So the question is, can we measure the underground economy? And I got a whole group of economists who say the whole underutilization rate of labor is not real. It's because my brother no longer tells anybody he's working. He does quite well, thank you very much, as a landscape contractor when you guys pay in cash. For those people watching at home, my brother's not a landscape contractor. I made it up. Don't chase him down. He's a really big guy. He'll beat me up first. No, a great question. And so how many of you, everybody close their eyes, raise your hand. How many of you here know people who are part of the economy that aren't counted by us crazy economists? Of course. And the answer is, do we know?
No.
Absolutely don't know. And more you're seeing bartering become part of the economy. Not just cash, not just this stuff, but a barter economy. And you're seeing more and more of it, and more people are doing that. And absolutely true, and there are a lot of economists who think that's the reason the data is getting worse and worse, or less and less reliable. By the way, there's a whole thing on, if you ever really want to make your brain, then you go out and you figure out how people even get these numbers. Because most of you in the room didn't fill out anything that gives me any data up here. There's surveys of small groups, and they're done, and they're self-reported, and they're all this trouble. So we tell everybody, one group of data is worthless. You know, one set of numbers. Any single set of numbers. 100 sets of numbers start to paint you a picture, but don't get married to them. They're just data. Yeah.
Isn't that data just pulled up by IRS or income?
Huh?
No, where's that?
Where do you mean the wage data?
Yeah.
Now it's pulled off of the data that y'all fill out on employments when you pay, most of this is unemployment insurance data. So you have to write down what people are what. But you self-report and you probably lie about it, so. Not you personally, but somebody. Well, I mean, where the jobs are. I mean, for years and years, I ended up being the Durham Economic Development Director years ago or so. And one of the things I noticed is it said on the little sheets that we had this one company of 14,000 employees that made certain types of computer equipment. And I knew the only company of that size was IBM, and I knew they didn't make that computer equipment anymore. So I, being the ingenious young man, I went out and said, you guys ought to change what, this ought to be something different. And they said, what are you talking about? We figured out that somebody had filled that out in 1978, and nobody ever changed it. And nobody ever asked them to change. It's like, well, and so I went back and said, so we ought to do this. And they said, well, yeah, but then our manufacturing numbers will look a lot worse, and maybe we shouldn't do that. And that's the kind of stupid stuff that makes these things crazy.
Yeah, we're more than doing our data analytics.
Absolutely. So we know that the biggest issue that we're facing business-wise in America, because we deal with it every day, is that we got all these people looking for work, and we got all these people who need workers, and we can't match. We're having so much trouble with that. Now, this is a global problem, too. We're down here with about 40% skill shortage. In some places, more. I mean, when we ask people around the world, and we do, maybe 10,000 employer interviews last year. Everybody says the same thing. People don't have the skills. Now, when we start digging the type of skills they need, some of them are what you said. There's some narrow skills. We do not have near enough people who are skilled trades, machinists, welders, I mean, radiology techs. I mean, there's a group of those. And they match, you know, they add up to 400,000 or 500,000 people around the country. And then we talk to people and they say, well, the real problem is I can't get anybody to show up for one. Or I can't get anybody to pass a drug test. Or I can't get anybody to. And you start figuring out that we have job skill problems specific. We have work skill problems that they can't get along. And then we have life skill problems, things their mama should have taught them to do if they don't do. They're all problems.
We have a stereotype problem as well. The students at the university, community colleges, as parents and grandparents, we don't know the really three major industries.
Correct.
The medical, the financial, industry being the top two. So the computer industry and computer science. You can't find children even in high school or even a 2-year degree to want to build a new trade.
Correct. In manufacturing, we do a lot of work for the National Manufacturing Group. 4% of parents want their kids to go to manufacturing. I mean, there's lower manufacturing jobs, but still 10% of the economy. And nobody wants to go in. And so what does a manufacturer do? Buys more robots. It's self-fulfilling, yeah.
We design a lot of these manufacturing plants, mm-hmm. and invariably, and there's more people working in the warehouse than in the plant.
Yep.
And all these high robots and high-tech machines are made in either Germany, mm-hmm. Italy, or Korea.
Yep.
We need to make the machines.
I agree with you.
Yeah.
I agree, and the number, I don't have the data off the top of my head, but the data is something like 20 years ago, 90% of people in a manufacturing facility needed a high school degree or less, and today that number is under 40, but most people need advanced skills, and we still are having trouble getting through that. This is, I put sources on most of these. This one says there's no source, I made it up. So I want you to know that. It says, I made it up. I did too. So none of this chart doesn't mean anything. It's just a question for you. The question is, have we gotten to the point where the demands of business have risen faster than the intellectual or motivational capacity of our citizens? Or is this gap caused because we don't know how to train people and educate people? I don't know the answer to the question, but I'm convinced that we do a crappy job of providing information, directing people. I don't want to track every kid. I really don't. But I also don't want to send 70% of kids to four-year colleges when the percentage of jobs that need a four-year degree is 23%. And debt. Well, not only do they get debt, they finish debt. They also all, you know, a huge number wash out. They weren't ready for college anyway. Half of them started in remedial courses. Most of those never got through. And they end up with no degree, huge debt, and no skill sets. There's a problem. And we're trying to get our hands around, and we're doing it by vilifying education, which I also think is wrong. I got teachers in my family. It's not that education is bad. Is that we're doing a bad job as a society. 90% of parents say they want their kids to go to a four-year degree and go to those three things. I mean, it's our fault. I said both of mine have four-year degrees. Neither of them are doing jobs they need a four-year degree for. They're both doing fine, but I sit back and go, that money that we spent, I could have done something different with that. So in the near future, what we see sort of, we'll let you be futurist for just a minute. Slow to moderate economic growth here and around the world, regardless of who's president. Anybody disagree?
No, I would disagree.
Who do you think is going to raise growth?
Not raising grades, yeah, I think it's gonna go down.
Oh, you think so? Well. Oh, it's gonna be huge. I will say that it is a lot harder not to be political these days when it's so much fun to do. Yeah. Will there be another recession in America?
Well, yeah,
it'll be another business cycle. Now, slow here for me, moderate is where we are, so slow is a loss, so I don't disagree with that. More globalization, although global trade may slow short term, urbanization is on its way, and this prosperity unevenness, both the people and places, are going to continue to grow, at least for the foreseeable future. The rapid technological change impacts everybody. The aging and diversity impacts everybody. We didn't talk much about diversity, but y'all know what the marketplaces look like. So we're, whether we like it, don't like it, whether we can stand and scream about it, want to embrace it, it's packed. So when we talk to local communities like y'all been doing, what we tell them is you cannot expect Washington, Raleigh, or even your local government to buy you out of your problems. They don't have any money. They have unfunded mandates at the federal level, you know it well. I mean, it's a great debate. Like, you know, I'm not, again, not political. Our rate of deficit has dropped dramatically, which means that your wife or husband is no longer charging as much on the credit card. But they're still charging more than you have every month, and you haven't paid anything off. And so, you know, it's better not to charge as much, but it doesn't deal with the principal problem. And the principal problem is better when a whole bunch of us old people die and the Gen X's are the only people we have to support because they're a small demographic. But in the long short run, it doesn't fix that. State government, North Carolina is in better shape than almost every state from a budget mandate standpoint because we pay for our retirement systems and our healthcare systems. We're at 97%, we're one of the top 10 best. Kentucky's at 50%, Illinois is at 40-something. I mean, they're gonna crash and burn. They're gonna default. We're not going to, but there's no more money. We've got, you know, billions and billions of dollars of unfunded infrastructure that we haven't figured out what to do with. Local governments, anybody think local governments are gonna raise enough taxes to be able to do what they need to do? Good question?
It's kind of a question. I don't mean this to be political, but I do find it to be something that I see, that concept that government will take care of us. And I think we've done a terrible job of really explaining to people that the government doesn't produce anything. The government doesn't generate anything. If somebody's paying for government, it's us, the guys that are working, the people that are working and everything. And I'm not sure that the overall population quite grasps.
Well, I don't disagree with you, but people could argue that lawyers don't produce anything. Not thinking of lawyers, but that consultants don't produce anything except paper. That a whole bunch of people. The concept of what a role of government is so different from society to society. I mean, if you're, you know, I'll get in trouble with this one too. I would take a bet with anybody today that within 30 years we have a single-payer national health system. There's all my friends in the medical field said there's no other way out of it. We're stuck. So we'll fight about it, but I would take that bet with somebody. Yeah.
If you give us, we lawyers, the power to tax, we will produce.
What do you want? Power to tax.
If you give lawyers the power to tax the population, we will produce plenty.
I would too. I think I would too. I'd get rid of those bottles from my house too.
Some of that government.
It's a job creation. It is. And my opinion would be that it would be a smart thing to do. That would be me. But again, I don't run for office, so I don't get to make those choices. I get to vote for people to do.
I'm struggling with a couple of things in my head.
Sure.
The pictures of China.
Yep.
The question about Korean equipment. The lack of infrastructure.
Yep.
Where do I go if I want to see reports on where global investment capital is
You could send me an email, send you, we do all sorts of, but FDI International or OFI, the Organization for International Investment, track those really well.
Okay, so why is that?
Select USA is another place to go.
So why is that going to Shanghai for infrastructure and construction and manufacturing and education? And you've got capital now in the private sector, I think that has to do with that.
Yes. Give you gigs, three gigs, yeah. Yeah, well, first of all, the United States has been the dominant recipient of foreign direct investment forever, and still is. So more people, now mostly it's Europeans who invest in the U.S. to get away from their cost structure. So the top people invest in the U.S. are always Germany, England, Denmark, and those kind of places. Asia had the type of investment because of the population growth. In America, we don't have many babies anymore. Women in America don't have enough babies to replace us right now. So our growth in America is almost, it's actually more than 100% immigration. So we are basically where Japan was going into the 90s. And they chose a non-immigration policy. This isn't political for immigration, just say this is the math. And so our growth rates are pretty slow. If you're in India today, your growth rates are crazy. If you're in Nigeria, they're crazy. If you're in Pakistan, what happened in China, and I spent a fair amount of time in China, is that China concentrated their growth in the cities. So people from the West moved east. And that big, I mean, Americans don't have many of those buildings in China. Those are mostly Singapore, Hong Kong, Korea, Japan, and the China growth. So this concept of we ought to be afraid of the rest of the world, I just say we were afraid of Brazil just a few years ago. Everybody in the world's got the same kind of problems we got. China's got a workforce that's aging problem much worse than ours. They also have a political system that if they don't keep the bar going straight up, their political system's in real trouble. I don't know if I should say our political system's in trouble now, but those kind of issues. I'm not worried about any single country. I'm worried as a globe, we're really starting to see a slowing of overall global growth. And we saw that in the 60s and 70s. And then technology freed us up. Everybody's been waiting for the next set of technology to raise productivity and growth. It just happened. I don't know if it will or not. I mean, if we knew that, that would be the big key. Yeah.
There was a comment just on the list, talking about China. Their biggest scare than the other world nations with the industrial revolution, research and development that the United States is doing, that no one can keep up as quick as we research, develop, and go to market.
Correct.
And that's what's going to continue us growing for the next 50 years.
China's lost more manufacturing jobs than we have. The jobs in China are now going to Vietnam and other places, lower cost jobs. We have friends in Denmark who still, one of the jokes in Denmark is that they're still mad at the Italians for stealing their textile industry in the 1600s. And if you go to Massachusetts, they're still mad at us, not that recently.
What are the implications of those cities on China?
So China, 6 years ago, the 5-year plan in China was to fix the urban rural problem. So they started building all these infrastructure things, and they put people to work doing it, and nobody moved. So one of the implications is that even if you're China, you can't make people move to places they won't go and move. So that's one of the implications. The other is that sunk resources.
Right.
So it's the same problem that anybody else would have. If you waste money on something that doesn't have a return, that you wasted it. We all waste money on something. You know, in America, we spend twice as much on healthcare as anybody else in the world. In France, they spend twice as much on food as anywhere else in the world so that they can have farms and cheese and whatever. We all pick our poisons. China was trying to, and China's brought more people in the middle class than the rest of the world combined over the last 20 years. So they've got good things going, but what they've got now, their internal debt, their internal banking debt. We talk a lot about them having our debt. They do, but they also have their debt. Their internal banking debt's tough. I mean, a lot of their banks would not be solvent without statements not holding. Yeah. So I think that's the real issue. I'm not, you know, India doesn't have the infrastructure. China doesn't have the glide path. I think we're all in this together, and I think that we're all going to have sustained lower growth than we hoped for. Real quick then, military reorganization is going to impact a lot of places around the country. It'll impact North Carolina. Whether Bragg becomes smaller or not is a real question, but we won't, the military won't look like it looks today, 20 years from now, because we don't fight wars the same way anymore. And we don't, you know, little guys with joysticks look like pilots today. It's easy to find a kid with a joystick. It's hard to train a pilot. It'll be different. The energy transformation is seeded now. It's on its way. 40% less coal use today, cheap natural gas. Solar energy prices are half what they were 18 months ago. Don't know how it'll shake out in the end. We'll still use all of the above, whether nuclear, small package nuclear comes back, who knows. But we're in a transformation form. A lot of people think that what energy will be over the long haul is individualized, that we'll have our own energy production in our house. So this idea, you know, that we can have, you know, at some point, a lot more people will be off the grid and energy will be short-term package. Then finally, I don't think that people in total will have bigger budgets going forward. Some of you, some people will have earned more money. But the overall rise in wages doesn't look real high for most people. And so consumption budgets, you gotta think about sort of how we consume in America. I mean, food has dropped in overall pricing in America by a significant amount. The amount we spend on food has gone up. Why? Yeah. That's a choice. Nobody here has to eat out, but you do. So we made that choice. Housing, the actual square footage of housing costs actually has gone down over the last 30 years. But housing's gone up because the size of the house went way up and the finishes went way up. Anybody know anybody who had granite countertops 30 years ago? All right, very, hello. Might be off the rocking. Well, maybe, yeah, might have a rocking in the backyard. Yes, I grew up on it. But I mean, think about it. I mean, and if you look at a house today, I mean, we were talking about this at our table last night. I'm 20-something kids. My 26-year-old daughter is out looking for a house in the Greensboro area. She's going through houses that she can afford, and she, you know, I don't think anybody would put, just there's a long list, formica, carpet, gold fixed. Why would anybody put any of that in a house? Why wouldn't you have, you know, she's looking at a 1968 house. Where's the walk-in closet and dressing room? It's like, So I think that we're looking at consumption being different, but we're not looking at consumption being more. Most people won't be able to do that over the long haul. Final things out of here. Demographics are really interesting as you look forward, because we run in demographic waves. So us baby boomers now are a smaller part of the population, a smaller part of the workforce than millennials. X is in the middle. For those of you in your 40s to early 50s here, y'all are a little bitty group. We have great potential as us guys get old, and I'm right at the end of baby boomers. So as I age out, if we're smart, we can get really healed nationally, financially, during your generation. Because you don't have near as much people we have to take care of. So somewhere in the 2030 range, the 2050 range, America could get out of debt and put itself on a much better position. In the short run, we don't have any money for education, we don't have any money for infrastructure because we're paying all of my bills for health and retirement. That's a problem. And so we're at a place in America where the arguments are young investment versus old tending. And that's not going to change. We're going to have that fight, so the politics of that will be that way for the next couple of years. So with that, I'll stop. Please follow us on Twitter or LinkedIn. We post every day on the economy, and I'll answer any questions for as long as that tells me I can answer. Sorry. Yes?
I've heard South Carolina's made a concerted effort to bring in higher-level manufacturing.
Yeah, what's known as advanced manufacturing, yes.
Driving up and down the highway to see those facilities. Do those intend to had, looking at the chart though, they only have, it seems like 1% more. Is that kind of the sentence?
Yeah.
Work?
Yes.
Is it worth doing?
So incentives work, but you can bribe anybody, I mean, it's all about negotiation, but, South Carolina has made some really big splashes. And unfortunately for us in North Carolina, we were in almost all the deals, and we lost. And so we're gnashing our teeth over it. Overall, South Carolina hasn't done particularly better than us. Economic development is about three parts. It's about having a product, and we don't have a port of big enough size to serve some of this. We never did. In the 1700s, we were the poor middle because we didn't have a deep water port. So we have specialized ports. It could be better at ag and some other things, but we don't. So it's about the product, and their product and our product are both pretty good. It's about the marketing. And North Carolina took a little bit of time out during our transition and didn't market very well. And it's about the transaction management. It's how do you close the deal, how do you do the incentives, how do you do that. And frankly, we were hurt for a while as we were transitioning. We did not have, in the last 2 years of Governor Perdue's reign and the first 2 years of Governor McCrory's, the economic development apparatus combined with the legislative ability and the governor, they could not get on the same page. And that hurts the transition resources. So I'm here tonight at dinner. This afternoon I'll be sitting by the pool, so if you bring me a drink, I'll answer anything. But tonight I'll be around if you want